formulates your life. It is religion that formulates your culture. What should be eaten, what not should be eaten. Whether you should eat vegetarian, whether you should eat beef, whether you should eat pork. It is the religion which formulates your culture. Now, today Nagarjuna University hosts a dinner for all of us. Will it feed us with beef? No. Because if it feeds with beef, the Vice Chancellor will come and stand up. Nagarjuna University, it will become a new one. Nagarjuna University gave a beef dinner. And then the whole debate starts. Should it do it? Now, if the Vice Chancellor gives us a vegetarian dinner with pappu, bendakaya, peerakaya, gongura, no problem. But the problem is, with beef alone the brain goes, pappu, birakaya, bendakaya does not allow the brain to go. Show me why science has not grown in India, the modern science. Why there is no single scientist? Is there a single scientist from India who is being studied as the original innovator in any universities of the world? Is there a single socio-political thinker who has constructed a new philosophical foundation for the world who is being studied outside? Except Buddha, there is none being studied outside. And Buddha was a beef eater. Buddha was a pork eater too. Now, the earliest science was discovered in the Buddhist world. Compass, gunpowder, paper printing machine were discovered by the Buddhist world before even Christianity was born. And later on, the science caught up in the Christian world. After Jesus said that we must sit on the table and eat on the table as table fellowship. And God is available to everybody, there is no need for mediation. And he was the one who said, in the kingdom of God, the first will be the last and the last will be the first. What does it mean? Some will know. It means that he said, the Pharisees, the Brahmins will be the last and the Samaritans who were Dalits at that time will be the first in the kingdom of God. Now, whether you have Samait Vishalandra or separate Telangana or separate Andhra, unless the Dalits are on the top and the Brahmins are on the low, society will not change. Now, unless the Dalits and the tribals, the Bahujans and the Sudras come into universities and develop these universities into scientific production centers, the Brahmins who have never been scientifically oriented in history, a Brahmin mind was never a creative, productive, scientific mind. Now, I couldn't understand in this country how from Gokhale to Tilak to Nehru to Gandhi, everybody went and studied in Oxford, Cambridge, and the Bengali Brahmins went and studied in Oxford, Cambridge, Harvard, and came back to India, started practicing untouchable. Is it a mind? Now, if somebody does PhD in Cambridge and Oxford and come back and thinks that if I touch somebody else, I become polluted, is this grown mind? This is a destroyed, primitive, underdeveloped mind. So the Brahmin mind is a destroyed, primitive, underdeveloped mind. And that is what Ambedkar understood. You take a simple example. From Gokhale to Nehru, what was the degree that they studied? In England, law. And all of them have generational education in their family. Today, what is the status of law in our university? Professor of law is the vice chancellor. Before this, private law institutes came, schools came. You know, students were not taking law course at all. They were thinking, if you do law, we don't even get married. That was the law thing. But at that time, the greatest science of the world, like the nanoscience today, computer science today, and more than that, that was economics. Economics was the greatest science. And the first generation untouchable man goes to Colombia and does PhD in economics, which Tilak to Gandhi to Nehru could not have done at all. There was no single PhD except Loya later. And the tragedy of the country was, he comes back with a PhD, does not get a professor post. I mean, if this is the unscientific mind of the universities, colleges, how does science grow? A man who does PhD there on a greatest subject called value of the rupee. I don't know how many of you read his thesis, Value of the Rupee. Ambedkar says, in 1893 when the British shifted the coin from silver coin to non-silver, also the value of rupee did not change. Then the provincial economics. So, by the time before Ambedkar was to reach, if India was not Brahmanic, India was not superstitious, Indian Brahmins were not brainless, they would have invited him to head any one of the universities here with a PhD. But they did not. He did not even get a house in Baroda, where Baroda Maharaja gives him a job in the military state. And the tragedy was, even the Brahmin pews were there. They were throwing the file and they were not giving him water too. And he resented himself. Then he did law. He thought that, you know, law is better than economics. He did law. And then he did another deal. Came back. Yet, his economic position was not good. So why India did not advance in science? Why there was Copernicus, there was Newton, there was Darwin, there was radio, there was everything in Christian world, church advanced there. Copernicus was given leave to discover cosmological changes by church. And did Tirupati temple give anything like that? What is the income of Tirupati temple? 16,000 crores. See, one day one fellow asked, he telephoned me, "Are Kancha Ilaiah, you are only Kancha Ilaiah?" I said, "Yes, I am only Kancha Ilaiah." Who asked you to write this bloody book? Oh, why I am not a Hindu? Did you write this book? I said, "What is your problem with that book?" "No, this book is destroying this country." I said, "Which is the great book making this country great?" He said, "Did you read Veda?" I said, "Which Veda I should read?" "Did you read Rugveda?" I said, "Who wrote it?" "No, you bloody, you don't even know? Rugveda was written by Brahma." I said, "Do you know who wrote Why I'm Not Hindu?" "It is not Kancha Ilaiah who wrote it, it was my goddess Pochamma who wrote it." Because there was a poster in front of my college, arts college, that how can Kancha Ilaiah write in such a great English, where he was educated under the free school, in a small village called Papayapeta. They know my details, more than anybody else. So this, he does not know English. The Christians have constituted a committee to write for him. They sit in Hong Kong and write for him. Then I said, if that is the case, this was RSS, ABVP put the poster. I said, "You call your Arun Shauri and Arun Jetli, and I'll give dictation. But that dictation will not be given by me, but by my Pochamma. Because Pochamma understands all languages. My mother prayed to Pochamma only. See, when I had this small car, she took me, she said, 'Pochamma, I will give you a Varepilla, గొర్రెలు పోస్తా, వ్యాపారం పెడతా, పసుపు పెడతా, రోగం పోవాలి, లేకపోతే మాత్రం బాగుండాలి అని చెప్పింది. రోగం పోయింది, గొర్రెలు పోతుంది, వ్యాపారం పెట్టింది, పడి పెట్టింది, అక్కడ పెట్టి మళ్ళా గంక రోగం వస్తే నీ మీద మట్టి పోస్తా అని చెప్పింది. పోతే మా అండర్స్టూడ్ అండ్ మేడ్ మీ వాట్ ఇట్ ఈస్, హీ అండర్స్టాండ్స్ తెలుగు. And if I go and talk to Pojamma today in English, he will understand. Right? You go and talk to her in Hindi. But does Hindu God understand Telugu? The Brahmin says, Hindu God understands only Sanskrit. Then I said, he must be stupidest God. If a God understands only one language, what kind of God is he? Because then I said, this fellow said, what do you want? He said, what do you want? I will resign my professor post. I want to become the head priest of Tirupati. How can you become, do you know Sanskrit? He said, why do I need Sanskrit? That is between me and Venkanna. We will take care of each other. First let me become head priest. Because there are 1,500 crores there. I'll have to do something with that money. That these people, here is a country, here is a religion which says God understands only one language. And that language others should not learn. America wanted to learn that language. So what happened today is, if you just compare, the Christian world produced all the time. And then came the Islamic world. What is the science that the Islamic world produced? You just look at Muhammad's life. I don't know how many of you read Quran and the history of Islam. See, by the time Muhammad was born, there was celibacy in Buddhism, there was celibacy in Catholicism, there was celibacy in Hinduism already. But all Hindu saints were celibate and had sex, full sex. Because out of wedlock, production was there. There were no ethics. Gods were having several wives. So Muhammad said, and by then what was the understanding? Menstruation was pollution, childbirth was pollution, and anything that comes out of the woman's body was treated as pollution. Sexual relations were treated as pollution. Therefore, celibacy in the religious core. Muhammad said, God created human beings along with their sexual organs. So sex is not pollution. You must be clean. That's all. Everybody can marry in Islam.